In 1970, no, maybe I should go a little earlier. In 1968, in my high school, I was asked, you can see I'm a young man. I was a much younger man, certainly over 40 years ago. I was asked to help to lead the school evening services. And I was quite a short boy, young, and people don't believe it these days, but because of leading choruses in the evening, because there was a compulsory Sunday evening service where all the students had to come together, and it was our job as a committee to organize the program for Sunday evening. Most of the time we did films. We used to come to NCCK and borrow films and show the films as part of the Sunday evening entertainment. But one of my key jobs was leading choruses. So if you came to my high school, 68, 69, that was my main job. The other day I learned that they had actually given me a nickname, but I never heard of it. It used to be John Wa Chorus now. But they never called me to my face, so I never heard of it until much later. And that was part of my learning to be involved in leadership more than 40 years ago. And then after that, I ended up, by the time I was Form 4, in the leadership of the Christian Union. After that, I went to A-level. I was involved in the leadership of the Christian Union. And after that, I went to the university. These days, you can say the university because there was only one. In the 70s, there was only one. So in the early 70s, so you could not mistake. These days, when you say university, you must say which one. But at our time when you got to university in Kenya, there was only one. You made a choice of either going to Nairobi or Dar es Salaam or Makerere, because it's a kind of a fellowship of universities of East Africa. So when you filled when you are doing Form 6, they could pick you to anywhere. Like I went to Nairobi, my wife went to Makerere, some other people went to Dar es Salaam. That's the way it was. So I went to Nairobi University, and within the first year, I actually joined the executive within the first year, and I was the prayer secretary. But that time, prayer secretary is not the prayer secretary in the campuses that I meet these days. I was prayer secretary in charge of organizing the prayer life of the University Christian Union. Number two, I was in charge of Bible study. These days, there are different jobs, isn't it? I was in charge of Bible study, so it was my job to go from hall to hall, trying to see that the Bible studies are running okay. And then thirdly, I was the external correspondence secretary. So the CEO had given me a typewriter, and I had a duplicating machine, and it was my privilege in those years, in 1974, it was my privilege to send letters throughout the world, because most of the university lecturers those days were Wazungus. And so when somebody finished his time and went somewhere in Australia, some in America, they were in my mailing list, and I used to send letters throughout. And in 75, I finally became the chairman of the University Christian Union. So my life as a young person then was spent in leadership. And so these days when I'm actually given an opportunity to talk to CU leaders, it is something that I value. Something that, in fact, only yesterday I wrote to Focus to tell them that we should get involved in training leadership. You are part of Focus, isn't it? And I was telling them that Focus philosophy is, it is not outsiders, although we need chaplain, but you need chaplain as advisors, not as the real workers. The work of chaplain is to equip the students to do the work of ministry. It is not the chaplains to do the work. It is the CU to do the work. By the way, I'm not original with it. That is in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, where the Bible says that the reason pastors and teachers and prophets are appointed in the church is to equip the church for the work of ministry. And you know now we mistake chaplains for ministers. That's not the Bible. The Bible says the members of the church are the ministers. The chaplains are equippers. But these days, when you see a reverend, you say minister. That's not in the Bible. Go and check your scriptures. The scriptures say it is the Christians who are ministers. It is not there. But you know, in the same term, you need to understand, which is right at the beginning of my introduction, that the work of the DCF committee is to equip, just like the chaplain, is to equip the members to do the work of ministry. So when you find a DCF, that is, and since I'm not in your place, I have the freedom to talk because I'm talking generally. I'm not talking about DCF Mombasa or DCF Nairobi day or DCF night. Now, we are talking about generally. I am involved for the last 30-something years. I've been involved in university ministry in all campuses of Kenya and actually even outside Kenya. So when I talk, do not think I'm talking about you. I'm talking about CUs generally. And I'm saying one of the things sometimes you find is the committee is appointed and it assumes the way to know the committee is working is for it to be seen to be working. The work of DCF is to work at the background to equip the members to do the actual job. So when I find the chairman in front every week, I know he's a hopeless chairman. I mean, it's somebody who needs help. And the good thing is he has come to Word of Life to get the help. So he's in the right place. When I find a secretary who wants to be heard every meeting, I know he is a hopeless secretary who is in the right place and needing help. Are we together? Because the job of the committee is not to do the job, but to equip people to do the job. Are you getting the point? And I told you, don't quote me. Go to the Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. That's what God expected. That when you are made a leader, your job is not to do the job, but to equip the people to do the job. And some of the mistakes I myself made in years gone by are the mistakes I would like to correct. So that even if you make mistakes, at least be original. Don't repeat mine. And basically, that's what training is all about. Training is to ask people who have made mistakes to share the mistakes so that you don't repeat them. You make original mistakes. And it's a very, because you will still make some mistakes, but at least they will be original. You will not repeat mine. So that's why we are here. And my intention is to speak for the next 35 minutes. And then after that, we have a discussion for about 15 minutes so that it doesn't become a sermon again. Are we together? So, the topic I have been given is developing the leader within you. You know, basically, we are talking about, and I'm sure you have covered many topics of leadership. Now we want to talk about developing the leader within you. You know, already by the very way the DCF leaders wrote to me, it implies they are already in the debate. That's a leadership debate. Are leaders born or made? Because you see, by saying developing the leader within you, first of all, it suggests that you're already a leader, you're already developing what's there. So you are subscribing to the idea leaders are born. So you are a leader within, you can now develop. But there are many leadership gurus who say leaders are not born. Leaders are made. That means even a guy who has never been a leader anywhere, if you give him the right developmental equipping, remember our term is equipping. Leadership is equipping. If you equip him right, he might turn out to be a leader. Every time I look at the TV and see, and you know my generation are the people in leadership currently, and your generation is coming soon. But you know, I see, for example, one of the ministers who was my classmate at Alliance. Every time I see him on the TV, I still remember at Alliance, he could not even be a food monitor. Am I communicating? There was apparently no leadership recognizable in him, even to make, not a food prefect, but even a monitor. And then even the way he communicates, you did not expect him that he can go to a rural constituency and ask for votes. So I kept asking, so and so, how does he actually ask for votes? And the truth of the matter is, and I won't give more details because you're likely to start guessing which minister I'm talking about. Now, even now he may not talk well. I don't think there he has improved a lot compared to our days at Alliance. But he's one of the top leaders known all over the world. So you need to understand that Both statements are true. Remember what I'm introducing it with? Are leaders born or made? It means you need to be aware that any one of us has some basic leadership gifts. And if they are developed, he can actually become one of the best leaders. What am I actually saying? That my personal subscription is, when you ask me, are leaders born or made? I say both. I don't subscribe to people who say that you cannot be a leader because unless you are born one. And I don't subscribe to the people who say, nothing, if it's not born, you can... No, no. There is something within you that disposes you to the leadership skills. But I want to suggest to you that if you are born and there is no making, you might try to be a leader, but you are unlikely to influence us. We will reject you as quickly as possible. So it is important to be aware that even if you have certain gifts within you, if you don't spend any time developing them, you will not become the kind of leader you should be. That's why after I retired, I have registered a consultancy and I'm helping various organizations try to develop their leadership. Because I believe that even if you are a manager, you require help to become a better manager. And so as you sit here, be aware that even if you don't regard yourself as very gifted, if you actually prepare yourself to develop, you can become better and better and better as you go on with your leadership. So I'm agreeing. Leaders are born. There is something within you that God has put. But I'm also agreeing. Leaders are made. Because there is a big difference between a leader who has tried to develop and a leader who has ignored development. So I am suggesting then that you can train yourself into better leadership. In other words, whatever level you are, you can actually become better. You must make the choice to create time to train yourself. Because without believing that you can improve, you are unlikely to invest in that improvement. If you wait for your friends or family or others, to whoever you want to say, to train you to become a better leader, you are going to take a long time. So I'm suggesting the responsibility for developing your leadership lies within you. In the sense that even to come for a meeting like this, you have to believe it is important enough for you to leave your classes in Mombasa to come here, isn't it? So I am suggesting to you that responsibility for becoming a better leader lies on you. And you know, you don't have a lot of choice, especially when you're involved in Christian leadership. I still remember that day when the former chairman, who were the people who had formed the Electoral College, came to my room in Hall 13, room 221, in the University of Nairobi, and told me that the chairman wanted to have a fellowship. He said, I've been sent by the Electoral Committee. After prayer, we believe the Lord is leading us to ask you to be the next chairman. But don't give an answer, pray about it also. Because I think they were wise. Because I had no idea that I would be the chairman of the University Christian Union. I regarded myself as not the type of people who can become the leader. So to ask me to be chairman, to say I was shocked, is an understatement. Because if you want, and I don't have enough time to deal with it, I had just, as a prayer secretary, I had just messed just before the elections. Just before we closed the year, there was, and if you remember, the KIA, no, you don't remember, you're not there. I will withdraw the word remember. But in 1975 is when KICC was opened. Kenyatta International Conference Center was opened in 1975. The first conference to be held there was a Christian conference of ICCC, International Christian, which is an opponent body to the World Council of Churches. They call themselves fundamentalists. And they were holding meetings there. We cannot forget because Moi was then the vice president, and he actually gave the head, one of the leaders of the conference, was given 24 hours. He was persona non grata and was actually chased out because he was so opposed to Catholics that he was speaking and it was appearing in the newspaper. But initially, I was seeing one of the speakers who used to come to speak to us in the Royalty of Nairobi. He's a personal friend. So he told me that he was involved in the organizing the conference, and that they will give the students an opportunity. Remember, we were the only university. Kenyatta was then becoming the university college of our university. So it was they felt, I think, it would be good for university students to see the conference. And of course, the students were even keen to see the inside of the building. Are you getting the point? Nothing about the conference, but a chance to go to the conference center. And they even offered to give us buses to pick us at the university to go to the conference center. So we were all very keen. And I'm the one who came to the executive, told them about it. They told me, that's a good idea. We announced. When we went there, we were given some tracts that had this kind of doctrine against the Catholics. And at the time, ecumenism was starting. In other words, the Protestants and the Catholics were trying to come together. There was also another fellowship called Charismatic Renewal. And Charismatic, it crossed both the Catholics and Protestants. So to actually have people who believe that Rome is the one with the heels in the book of Revelation. Are you getting the point? So that it was very clear that Rome is the one mentioned in the book of Revelation. And they are saying it openly, and it's being written in the newspaper. When we came back, people were literally mad with me that I could have taken them to a meeting like that. In the next executive, the committee wanted to change the agenda for Nganga to become the first topic of discussion. Because they also had such a pressure from the membership about how could you allow us to go to a meeting like that. Unfortunately, that committee meeting was the committee meeting before we closed. And you know the way university closes, it doesn't close normally. You finish your exams and disappear. It doesn't still happen. Yeah. So I had no time to explain to the members that I also did not know. So we closed for 3 months without ever having a chance to apologize or even explain. Of course, the executive I was able to handle. Because when they wanted to discuss me, I said, first of all, that the agenda is clear. Why it is not, my Nganga is not on the agenda. Follow the agenda. That allows the temperatures to cool. So by the time I was now discussed at the end, the temperatures were down. And then my next question is that a decision Nganga made or a decision the executive made? If you make a decision, it becomes an executive, and that's a very important thing to understand. You should never allow a discussion for a decision to be made when you are present, because after that you lose the right to point fingers. As long as the minutes say the decision was made, every member becomes liable. Are we together? And you cannot start pointing to Nganga. And obviously they realized. And so I was able to handle the executive. So can you imagine, as we came back after closure, and now it was 3 months later, you can't raise the matter. I knew that the general average person was fed up with Nganga. So for the chairman to come and ask me to become the chairman, the next chairman, can you understand now my shock? Now, anyway, I don't want to spend time on that, but I just want to tell you that I certainly needed God's help. That's the first thing. The second reason why I needed God's help was the fact that being the only university in Kenya, it meant that the leadership of this country depended on those people. You are sure, as you came out, in fact it was automatic, if you came out with a BCom and with very cooperative management, you immediately became a district cooperative officer with a Land Rover. A young boy of 25 would be the district. That it was automatic. University graduate. If you came out as a veterinary, with a degree in veterinary, you became the divisional veterinary officer with a Land Rover. Are you getting the point? So we used to be young old men, if you understand. So if you could prepare them right, which is the work of the Christian Union, can you imagine the impact they'll make in this nation? And I looked at it and said, God, what a responsibility to give me. That this country would be made or unmade, but how we as a committee are going to handle our responsibility. And it frightened me. It made my legs start having fellowship. And so it was good that the guy never told me to have an answer. He asked me to pray. And during the prayers I prayed, I now realized that the fact that my legs were having fellowship was just a way of the Lord reminding me It is him appointing me, it is him to equip me. Are we together? And so I took the job aware I didn't qualify, I needed God to help me. And by the way, things have not yet changed. One of the dangerous things when the Bible, don't again quote the Bible, one of the dangerous things is to agree to join DCF. You could have gone to heaven without DCF. The day you joined it, it may block your entry into heaven. Because as a member of the CU, you're just a member responsible for you and you are going to heaven. The minute you join the executive, your impact is such that it can block your heaven. By the way, it's not me saying it. Look at the Bible. It says, let fear of you be teachers. Have you read that? that you should not be in a rush to enter a committee. It's dangerous. You could have gone to heaven. The thing that will stop you is joining the leadership. Because you are now no longer responsible for yourself alone. You are responsible for others. If, for example, you are just a member of the CU and you start rioting, that's bad. God will hold you responsible. But if others see a leader rioting, you are not only responsible for your rioting, but the others copying your rioting. Am I communicating? So you start understanding that to become a leader is a frightening thing. You should not be rushing into it. Because you are rushing a curse. You are running for a curse. Because if you don't handle your leadership properly, God will hold you accountable. And it's an important thing. So that's the second thing why I needed. Remember, our topic is developing the leader within you. And I'm giving you the reasons why you have no alternative than to look for opportunities to develop. Because if you are going to be held accountable, then you cannot be a mediocre leader. Because when you are mediocrity, it's not your choice. God will hold you accountable for your mediocrity. Thirdly, this is the reason why I needed a lot of help is the fact that I have to struggle with my books and also struggle with being a leader. And I want to tell you for I don't know how your campus is, it means enough work as a chairman. You have enough responsibility as a chairman for it to become a full job. And yet, if you fail your exams, you need to understand your mother will not understand. You yourself should not understand anyway. It's important to understand you must find a balance. And you need God's help. Because a lot of people accept leadership because they want the title, but they do not want the sacrifice it's going to require. Because what that means is, you will be available to people, but when they choose to sleep 8 hours, you as a leader must choose to sleep 6. Why? 3 hours of the night you spend paying for the hours of the day you are not reading, but you are doing Christian Union work. Am I communicating? And if you don't do that, you will fail your exams. Alternatively, you will not be a good CU leader. Both of them, you are not allowed to fail. Am I communicating? You must find out. And so you needed God help to help me to be able to create that balance that allows me to be a very good student and a very good leader all at the same time. You are not allowed to have one or the other. If you know clearly you don't want to sacrifice in order for you to be the kind of leader DCF requires, please, the better thing is to resign as quickly as possible. Otherwise, you'll get yourself a curse. Why did you accept a leadership role which you knew very well you examined? One of the reasons, we used to use a leadership, I don't know if they still do it in the University of Nairobi. The reason we used to use an electoral college is because after the vote, you did not determine the next committee on the basis of who had the maximum vote. You looked at the vote, but you also looked at his academic ability to handle his academic work. And you looked at his ability to work with others in order to determine whether you join the executive or not. Because it's very important that you do not allow somebody to become a chairman and then you mess up his academic work. Are we together? Because it will be important that you are able to create that balance. By the way, that has not changed. In the last 30-something years after I left university, I discovered the training university was a training ground, because as I came out of the university, we came out in those days, university used to finish in June. By September, I was already invited back in the University of Nairobi to speak. Then after that, in Kenyatta University, into a high school. and my life has been like that for the last many years. And that meant that I have to balance work at Shell, and Shell does not want to know I preach, and also still continue preaching. Because the gift of God is in me, and he expects me to carry out both. Am I communicating? So that it's not just simply something you will do in the university. Even after university, it will be something. So what we are saying is, I'm giving you reasons as to why you must invest in development. It's because you really don't have a choice than to succeed. Let me say this. Three things are required of every leader in order for a leader to do well. So that as you develop the leader within you, you need to be aware. First, and I don't have enough time to deal with it, this is each topic you could deal with on its own, is vision. There is no way you will ever qualify to be a good leader if you don't know where you are taking the group. So vision, or the ability to visualize and communicate the vision of the group. That's why I always advise any committee, before you got the job of doing the committee's mandate, is to find out, between now and the time we hand over, what's our vision? In other words, what is vision? What's the picture of the product after you have processed it? That's what you are looking for. And every committee must sit to see the vision. In other words, and I'm saying vision is not what you do, it's the result of what you do. It is the final product. Normally say vision is like an architectural picture of a completed building even before you have bought a plot. Are you getting the point? That you are clear what you, that's why that's what will drive you to know where to buy your land. When you seek picture where the house can fit in. But it's already complete. Every committee must have that picture complete. What kind of a CU product do you want to produce out of this CF Mombasa? In other words, after people have gone through the Desta University Mombasa campus, after 4 years, because of the work of this year, the final product will be like this. It is when you get that vision that you get an idea of what to do. Because what you do is determined by what you want to get. Are we together? And I want to say that anybody who doesn't develop that ability to be proactive, to look ahead, and is too tied up with how are you jumping, how are you singing, is the choir now, those are details. What you sing and how you sing is not as important as why you sing and how you, am I communicating? It is important of what you want to produce, because what you want to produce will determine the choruses you select, isn't it? So it's important that leaders are differentiated on that one key factor. The ability to see. There are people who sit down, you want to organize a meeting, and they can quickly, they don't begin with the details of organizing. They want to say, oh, we are going to have a rally. What do we want to get out of that rally? Not the details of how to run the rally. What is the final product of that rally? And it's a critical requirement for leadership. You must develop. It's not easy. We are lazy by nature after the fall of Adam. So the number thing is, what do you want to do? We are organizing a rally. Who is the speaker? Now that's a hopeless way of organizing. You don't bother to ask who is the speaker until you say, what do you want to produce? When you know what you want to produce, that you want people who will be better Christians in the area of quiet time. Because we don't believe they're spending. Now that will now determine the topic. What you want to produce will determine the topic. You don't say, which topic are we going to have for the rally? No, you don't need a topic. You need a vision of what you want to produce. Once that is clear, it will now determine the topic. And by the once the topic is clear, it will determine the speaker. Speakers is the last thing. You don't bother with speakers. Speakers are the last thing you ever want to mention. Unfortunately, what I'm teaching you is taught and practiced by the church. It's always the name of the guy. Hey, who do we want? We want the great evangelist Jokoko. You know, Reverend Jokoko. Now, Jokoko, so why do you want him? You know, it is when you are actually now coming to details. If you start thinking about the topic later and you say, we want somebody who can help us to cross from singlehood to marriage in a good way. That's when you realize that Reverend Jokoko is a great man, has been preaching for the last 30 years, but when he was a young man, he actually eloped with his wife. Now, what kind of a speaker who advise you? First of all, you don't think that you want to embarrass him. No wonder you have invited him to speak on that topic. Now, are you getting the point? You should never ever discuss who the speaker is until you know the topic. And you should never discuss the topic until you know what you want to get. Am I communicating? That ability is a leadership requirement. And unfortunately, in Kenya, it is something that is in dire need. We generally go to practicals. You know, we'll do this, we'll collect offerings. Why are you collecting offerings? Some of the meetings you don't require any offerings. So it is not what was done by somebody else. What do you want to achieve through your day? So it's vision, the ability to see the future, conceptualize it, and be able to communicate to others is one of the requirements of leadership. Number two, people skills is the other thing. I told you I will give you many things, but I'm summarizing them to three areas. You will not be a good leader until you know how to deal with others. There are people who are so bad at people skills that somehow you wonder how they survive. You ask them very clearly, would you like to move? Surely, you think I'm your houseboy. Now, surely, all I wanted is for you to move to the next. Now, but somehow he has such insecurities within him that whatever you want him to do, the insecurities come out openly. Because why is he thinking I'm thinking of he is a houseboy? It's because he himself thinks he's a houseboy. Now, and see what you also know. Now, that's why he is so worried. But when you are confident, you just ask, oh, there is another chair. You want to move? Yes. I'm moving to the next chair. Am I communicating? The interpersonal skills, there is no one of the key requirements of leadership is the ability to influence, and I'll be coming to it in a minute. And you can't influence unless you know how to relate with other people. If you don't have that gift, you need to develop it as quickly as possible. If you are the type of person who people look at you and realize, wow, these are like eggs, handle with care, right side up. Have you seen the cartons of eggs? They always written, handle with care, right side up. And there are people who are like that. Every time you see the sister, you realize, handle with care, right side up. Now that person should not claim to be in leadership. Am I communicating? If you are the type people are wondering, you can't influence them. They are looking, every time they see you, they are in defense. Because they don't know, they seem to hurt you every way. And they don't want to hurt you yet again. Now, it's important to understand interpersonal skills is a requirement. You need to be what we call in management a people person. Somebody who enjoys being with the people and enjoys talking with them and enjoys relating with them. How can you lead? Because leadership is not a job. Leadership is organizing people. What do they say management is? Those of you who are doing BCom. Management is getting results through others. That's what management, definition of management. Getting results through others. So it means it is not you doing. You are organizing people, what we called earlier, equipping, for them to get results. So how can you get results? You know, most of the people without people skills never become good leaders. Because they are looking at producing the thing rather than helping people to produce whatever the item they require. Thirdly, is now technical skills. You need the skills to have the vision. You need the skills, what I'm calling people skills. You also need what I call technical skills. And technical skills now refer to the particular activity for which you need. For example, if you are going to lead people to Mount Kenya, and like you can guess, my children went through Desta, and I know, do they still climb? When they were in university, they used to, two of them actually went and climbed Mount Kenya. Do you still climb? And one of the things, I've never climbed, even the lower part. And so I listened to their stories about climbing the mountain. One of them has actually started helping. What was that thing called that used to organize the trips? Doulos, yeah. Started helping with doulos, and so she went for a second round to help others to climb. So I've picked the issues about leading. Do you know anybody can lead a group? But it will be particularly useful if you have been to the mountain before. In other words, you can have the vision, clear understanding how the mountain is. You can even do geography and physics of the mountain. But it is important that you have been to the mountain before. Am I communicating? It will certainly help. It's not, you can go, you can still lead, even if you have never been there, but you'll be a better leader if you have been there. For example, if you are to become the CEO of Kenyatta Hospital, anybody could be, but it will be particularly useful if you are medically trained. Am I communicating? The technical skills help you to. For example, if you are to be the chairman of the Christian Union, it will be important that you are born again. Am I communicating? It will be important that you also pray. It will be important that you also sing. It will be all the activities, the technical activities that the CEO does. You may not be good at them, but it will be important that you know something about them. Am I communicating? Technical. So, you with those three, it's a marriage. You need vision, you need people skills, you need technical skills, all of them. None of them, if you don't have any one of them, you have a problem. However, they are not equally important. They are all important, but not equally important. Let me tell you. If you are the level, what we call in management, you can be staff, or you can be supervisor, or you can be manager, or you can be CEO. Those are four levels. If you are just supervisor, leadership at a lower level, you don't require the same amount of vision as a CEO. The senior you become, the less technical you are. Because at a very senior level, you never, for example, you are running a hotel, you never make eggs. You don't even appear in the kitchen. Am I communicating? You have so much work in the office, you may not even see how a kitchen looks like. But you are still the leader, isn't it? So you then can understand at the CEO level, technical abilities are important, but they are not the most important. For the person at the CEO level, the most crucial issue is vision. Because most of his time is spent thinking, where is this hotel going? What can we do? The same thing with the lead, the chairman of DCF. His greatest importance. That's why the chairman is not normally given a specific technical task. Because his biggest job is to think helicopter view. To see where is the CEO going? How can it get there? His major job is visionary. Are we together? So it is important to understand they are not equally important. The more senior you are, the more important it is that you have a vision. Number two, technical skills are more important than the vision. For example, if you are a cook, then it will be 80% of your job is technical. And then about 10% is people skills. Give me that egg. No, give me that. How to ask for it. Are we together? But only 5% or so is likely to be visionary. Nobody asks you, are school is coming? Or is it winter? It is summer? No, that has nothing to do with the kitchen. The kitchen only wants to know how many eggs you want me to fry. So the lower you are, the more technical abilities are required. When you are in the middle management, you require almost all of them at almost equal level. Since you are the one who interprets what the vision that the board has said, you require vision. Since you are the one supervising the technical skills, you require technical skills. And since you have to bring the team together, you require people skills. Let me tell you, the one thing that is required in all the three levels is people skills. The vision must be communicated. Communication is a people skill, isn't it? The people in the middle have to be a team. People skills again. And even the guy at the lower level, supervisor, now not the cook, but the supervisor of cook. Are they called chefs? Now the chef. Not the chief chef, but the chef at the bottom. You know, there is a chef for eggs and a chef, I'm imagining. A chef for eggs and a chef for ugali, you know, whatever. Whatever the coordination, he requires people skills, doesn't it? So can you see then that you must develop every part of those skills, but especially the people skills. You still require the vision and the technical skills. I have told you they are important. But the one thing that you must have are people skills. I have to finish. But am I communicating? That you can see every one of them. Don't feel like because you are such a visionary guy that you don't want to know the technical.
You can't really operate well. Even the CEO requires some technical. Isn't that what I say?
It is only not as much as the other.
So every member of DCF must know something about the issue. Although we say the work is done by the CEO members, you must get involved enough to understand what are the challenges of morning prayer. Am I communicating? Even if you don't attend every prayer meeting, you must know what are the challenges. That is technical. And the unfortunate thing is a lot of leaders are hanging loose. After all, I'm the leader. You can't do much leadership without technical ability. Whatever is both the nuts of your department, of your organization, must be known. Even in charge of prayers, after technical area, it will be important. But in the same way, you require a vision, the ability to think ahead. For example, even if you are not the chairman, if you are the one who leads the prayer department, you need to think your future of prayer, isn't it? And the question of why we pray. It will be important that you discuss them. So it's important that is done. So, as I finish, it will be important that you have motivation to learn. Motivation is a key requirement of leadership. Unfortunately, the work of the leaders is to motivate others who motivate them. Because you cannot be a leader requiring motivation. If you require motivation, please resign. I'm not motivated. If you are not motivated, you are saying, I don't want to be a leader. Because your job is to motivate the unmotivated. What who motivates you? It means you, that's what we say, the leader within you. You have to find a way of you yourself from within you, finding a reason for that growth. I argue, I don't know if any one of you has read my book, A Leader's Source of Influence, and I talk about self-management. And I argue that you are unlikely to become a leader until you learn self-management. If you pick that book, Leader's Source of Influence by John Nganga, pick the chapter on self-management, because that's our topic today. That you must find a method of managing yourself so that you do not require to be motivated. You are motivating yourself. And I say, and I don't have the time to go into it, I say you must divide your life into about 7 areas in order to manage yourself properly. The first area we say is, first of all, I divide it into 3 areas. What we say, private, personal, and public. Those are 3 areas. If you are trying to develop the leader within you, think about the private area, the personal area, and the public area. Which is the private area? I divide the private area into 3 areas. The private area is my mind. And I must ask myself, how am I developing myself mentally? I made a decision in high school in 1969 that every day I'll be reading a book which is not part of the classwork. That was quite a few years ago. And I want to tell you, even today, you can ask me what book I'm reading. Okay, if you talk to my children, they may not be impressed in the sense that sometimes when they went to boarding, they leave me reading a book in January. When they come in April and find me the book, they really laugh. You are still reading the same book. I said, yes, I made a commitment to read. I didn't say how quickly. But I'm always reading. Because at that time, I didn't know I'll be asked to speak. But there's no way you'll be able to help others if you are not developing your mind. And it's important as a person to ask, are you reading books that can help you in leadership? What are you doing about it? It's important to develop your mind. The second thing I say in my book, you must develop your body. The risk of a leader is to be so busy, he has no time for exercise. And you know, exercise should not be something the doctor asks you to have when you are born again. Because we have it in the Bible. The Bible says, bodily exercise profited. Don't finish the rest of the sentence. But it is that what the Bible says. Actually, the end it says little. But remember, for it to profit little, it means it's profitable. Am I communicating? It's only that spiritual exercise is even more profitable. But physical exercise is already profitable. That's the Bible that declares bodily exercise is profitable. So if you are a young person and you are so busy in this year, you don't do exercise, you are sinning. Because the Bible is the one that told you bodily exercise is profitable. Somebody found me in a swimming pool. I said, Nanga, you also swim? Now, in In other words, they assume that Brother Nanga is so busy, they think like I have accident to be found in a swimming pool. I say, but read the Bible. The Bible says, if I don't do exercise, I'll not profit. Because bodily exercise is profitable. Do you know, when you are tired, your body is tired, you may have a wonderful message to share in the DCF meeting. But as it shows in your face, it can communicate. And it's not because of your heart. It's because of your heart is contained in a body. And that body is complaining. It has not had any exercise. Am I communicating? So it's important. We say the first thing is develop your mind. The second is develop your body. What you eat is important. You can eat certain things, and when you go to this year meeting, you are dozing because of what you ate and how you ate it. So it's important to check your body. That is developing your body by what you eat, when you eat, and how much of it. Are we together? And then rest is important. So anyway, we are talking about the body. The third area in your private area. Remember why I'm calling it private? It's because nobody can manage you. Literally nobody can develop your mind. It's a decision you make. Nobody can deal with your body. They can keep saying you are fat, but that's none of their business. It's your body. Am I communicating? So as a leader, if you want to be a better leader, you must manage your body. And don't start thinking that the thin ones are better. Because the reason they are thin is because they are dying. It's very important. It's very important to be aware that health is not the size of the body. Are we together? There are people, one of my housemates, when I was a bachelor, one of my housemates, I used to say, you are an embarrassment. Because we are sharing a house, we are three of us, we used to sit in Arab West. And we are three of us. We, two of us, we are looking healthy. Our third guy was getting thinner and thinner. I said, you embarrass us. Whenever your relatives see you, they'll think we finish eating your ugali. Now, but we discovered that the guy cannot get any fatter. Somehow there are people like that. Have you met them? They are eating double our share, but getting thinner. Are you getting the point? So it's not, we are not talking about the size. You can be healthy and whatever. Anyway, let's say. So when you see somebody thin, it doesn't mean there's something wrong. When you see them big, it doesn't mean there's something wrong. You need to think. And that's why you yourself need to manage yourself. It's very important that you manage yourself properly. Now, so physical, it is important. Remember, our topic is we are talking about developing yourself. And you are saying it will be important. The third area is the heart, spiritual. That's all private. Do you know whether you have your quiet time or not? Even your mother cannot tell. There are days she could tell, but these days she cannot tell. Whenever you meet her, you can say, hallelujah, mom. I'm here walking with the Lord. But the last time you read the Bible is last year. Now, nobody can tell. And I want to tell you, your leadership will be determined by your closet hours. If you literally, you are talking about spiritual leadership, and you have no spiritual content, it will soon show in the type of a leader you are. You know, without spending time with the Lord, somebody is going to tell somebody to rap you the wrong way. And then you give them a piece of your mind. And when you get the habit of giving a piece of your mind, it will soon be empty. Because you see, you give a little. Keep giving a piece of your mind, and you soon have nothing left in the brain. So it's important to know, it is the time you spend in prayer and with the Lord that makes you have a cool reaction to an otherwise provocative reaction in a DCF meeting. Am I communicating? So it is, that's what we are calling the private area. Because if you don't have it, you'll never be a good leader, and it will be because you are not spending time. Then there is the personal area. The personal area is where you have a group of friends and relatives whom you are free enough with them to be able to expose yourself to them. Because these are the areas that are private and personal. But you require to have a personal area where you relate with the people, friends and family. And if you don't have those kind of people, you will be having a piece of ugali at the back, nobody can tell you. But when you come out and there was a piece of ugali, your daughter put on you without you realizing. As soon as your friend sees you, they will come quickly like they are hugging you. Kumbe they are removing ugali. Am I communicating? You require people like that, who instead of bursting to laughter, they quickly cover you up. Do you have a friend like that? They are not easy to come by. And normally you don't require your toes to count them, because already your fingers are too many. I have written a book called Friendship.
And I argue, many of the people we call friends, if you have a small book, if you ever have an opportunity to buy, my books are distributed by Biblica in the Reinsurance Plaza. If you ever have an opportunity to pick that book, it's a small one, where I argue about who is a friend. How do you make a friend? What are the benefits of friendship? What are the dangers of friendship? And I'm saying that the personal area, a leader who doesn't have a group of people, and they don't even have to come from the DCF committee. They can be anybody, but people whom you trust enough to be open, to say, by the way, today, I just messed up. The way I spoke to that sister, I was a total mess. Before her, you behaved strong. Yes, I'm the chairman. But you have to go to somebody and say, I was a total mess. Pray with me. If you don't have somebody like that, you'll be the weaker, spending all your time in defense. Any leader who wants to develop must have a few people who are like that. Of course, God gave us our spouses, and most of you are not that level yet. But one of the critical things you want to hope is that if you ever marry someone, you don't marry someone with whom you have something to prove. Like, you're so rich, you are so poor, you spend the rest of your time trying to prove, although you came from a poor family, you're also great. Now, that kind of a person, you don't marry them. Marry someone who accepts you as you are. And you accept them as they are. That means you can go before them. You know, like at work, and I'm now using a different example, you don't have. At work, you have a lot of pressures. And sometimes you do something like working for a multinational. By the time I retired, I was in the leadership team. And you are signing things that is equal to billions of shillings. And you make a mistake. And just by the mistake of a decision you have made, the company has lost 3 million shillings. If you tell that to your juniors, they will go talking, saying, sure, he is not qualified to be our boss. And they would be telling your boss to fire you. After all, I can do better job than them. So you dare not share with your subordinate. You cannot tell your boss, you say, no wonder I want to fire you. So you are not able to tell your boss. So you think you can tell your colleagues. Don't they know all the four of you are looking for the CEO's job? So as soon as you tell them, they go and tell the CEO, I know we are equal with so and so, but I really regret for the way he runs his department. In other words, to tell you, when the opening comes, he should not be a candidate. That way you are reducing competition. Am I communicating? So you can't share. Who do you share with? You require that group of people you can share with. And the best one is especially your spouse. Where once you lock the bedroom, you can go there feeling so frustrated, although you are a man, and especially African men are not supposed to cry, suppose is the word, you go before her, you put your head on her lap, cry like a baby. Oh no, I messed up, I messed, you cry, says, fall apart, fall apart. And they say crying is therapeutic. Now, after you have cried, you wash your face, you open the door, you know very well she is such a friend, she will never tell people, by the way, wakwaneri raga. Now, you don't go ever telling, say, my husband cries. No. She is a wife. So she will never tell people that at night you normally cry. But you know, because if you feel she can do that, will you cry? No. So you require a help. And as I'm saying, that helps you to develop as a leader. And you require people whom you can share with, and they have the sense of confidentiality. Are we together? Because you don't want a story which you could not share with anybody, and you have chosen to share with so and so, being repeated somewhere else. Are we together? So it's important that you share. So that's the personal area. And then the final area is what we call the public area. The public area is how you deal with the public. And you need to develop yourself. So anyway, read the book. You understand what you're talking about. But to me, what we are saying is development is self-motivation. Now, I've completely run out of time. Therefore, I'll just finish and say three words. Self-development or developing the leader within you is, first of all, accepting the responsibility. That not an outsider will make you a better leader. It's your personal responsibility. But number two, if you are to do that, you have to discover yourself. You must do a SWOT analysis on yourself. What is SWOT? Strength, weakness, opportunities, and? Yeah.
We normally do SWOT analysis for organizations. I hope you have done a SWOT analysis for DCF day. Or is it DCF night? Now, you must do a SWOT analysis. But in addition to doing a SWOT analysis of DCF, you must do a John Nganga SWOT analysis, where you know your strength, your weaknesses, your opportunities, and your threat. Remember, although I'm not dealing with that just now, remember, weakness is not every weakness. It's a weakness that stops you from your mission. Other weaknesses, and we have many weaknesses, those are not the ones you list. You only list weaknesses that are preventing you from realizing your call, God's call on your life. Are we together? For example, if you have a weakness in running, but you have never been interested in getting a gold, that's not a weakness. Nobody requires you to be running. Am I communicating? Yeah, that's not a weakness. Weakness is, once you know, and again, if you read my book, A Leader, Source of Influence, one chapter is called Discovering Your Mission. Because once you know your mission, then you can do your SWOT analysis. SWOT analysis is my weakness against what God has called me to do. My opportunities to do what God has called me to do. And my threats. What will threaten my ability to actually accomplish what God has called me to do. You must see it in that context. So that's the first thing you do. And you have to repeat that regularly. You need to admit to yourself that on this area, I am not good at. I have to work on it. But on this, I'm strong. Once you discover it, then you spend more time developing your strength than correcting your weakness. Because some of the weakness, there isn't much you can do. You improve them, but don't cry over them. Are we together? Because God knows you still can accomplish your mission. But if you know what happens as a leader, once you know your weakness, then you look for people in the committee who have the strength in your area of weakness. You are able to team up. No wonder the Lord called us into teams. Because he knows your weakness is somebody else's strength. Are we together? So that's what really discovering is all about. Through personal assessment, your strength and weakness of your behavioral style, your drive, your motivation, your attribute thinking, all of them have to be analyzed. Discover what your job or mission is, then discover what are the things that are preventing you or assisting you to go ahead. Once you discover there are three D's. The first D is discover. The second D is define. Refine your understanding and outcome to influence others through your behavior, values, and attributes. You must do what we call a competence gap analysis. Competence gap. In other words, to do this, I need this. And you have to do what the discrepancy between. Identify the strength and discrepancy in your personal job match performance. In other words, for me to perform better, this is what I actually need. You know, when you talk about training, some people call it TNA, training need analysis. But it may be not needing training, a lecture. It may be something somebody else will help you. And you can go to them and say, mentor me on this area, because this is my area of weakness. So what you are saying, define what is the gap. How big is the gap? And then you go to the third one, which is develop or close the gap. Develop yourself or close the gap. How do you do that? I've already referred to it through a model or mentoring or coaching. So it can be modeling or coaching or mentoring. You need to look for somebody who is like what you want to be. And that way, learn from him. By the way, some of our mentors are not physical. Some of our mentors are books. You look for a book that deals with your area or somebody's biography that can give you encouragement. But some of them are physical. Are we together? My normal recommendation is you don't need one mentor. For me, I don't believe in that idea of a mentor. So and so is my mentor. I have never met a human being, and John Ngang is among them, who doesn't have weaknesses. So when you have one mentor, you might get his strength and his weaknesses. So you need this guy to help me here, this guy to help me here. So you need many mentors, each one in the area of need, once you have done your analysis. Are we together? So don't have one guy. You must choose in your mentor or coach what to pick and what not to pick. Because every one of your mentors has weaknesses. So identify them, don't pick them. Because the reason you went to him is because he is strong in this area. The fact that he is weak in other areas, that's human. Pick what he is strong at and you'll help him. Am I communicating? So it's important. So mentoring, coaching is important. But also, it will be that you personally target materials that can help you. They can be CDs, they can be books that are going to help you to grow. Sorry, I have completely messed up the time, but I hope somebody has benefited somewhere. Can we quickly, I may have said something that confused you. Now is the time to unconfuse you. So ask a question, but it could also be a comment. In other words, you don't have to be asking a question. Is there something that has blessed you and you want to share how it has blessed you? And you use different words from mine, and that will still help other people. Yes. Yes. Motivation, when I talk about self-motivation, we are talking about, young people, I hear them calling it psych. Ever heard of the word psych? You are psyched up. There's something you do and you want to do it with a passion because it tells you this matters to me. But sometimes you do something because it's a duty. That's the difference. A motivated, self-motivated person has a passion for what they do. A guy who is doing it as a duty, I'm the secretary, what do I do? Let me write these minutes. This is my cross. Now, that kind of an idea is not motivated. Am I communicating? So it's important, that's what the difference is. So motivation is the passion from within to accomplish the task. And what you are saying is you can motivate other people. And sometimes the way you motivate them is by saying, what are the benefits? You know, if you do this, like now, a lot of preachers have found the way to raise money is to tell you, if a man of God prays for you, you'll get the money. Send me $1,000 and you are healed. Have you heard that on TV? That's called motivation by a lie. Now, that basically is something that you have to deal with. Where you are, somebody is giving you a reason for you to be encouraged. That's the word you use. But for you to have an inner passion for what you do. But I am saying, don't rely on other people. Let it come from within. And from the things I told you, like your personal time with the Lord in prayer, what I call quiet time. That's where He will show you things that will cause you to go that day with vigor because of your time with the Lord in prayer. That's a private time. That's a good question, yes?
You talk about the personal area.
Yes.
You talk about close people, friends, relatives.
Yes.
When the man talked about the spouse.
Yes. Remember, I started by apologizing that I'm using an example where most of you are qualified. Do you remember me saying that? So I'm aware. But I know many of you look forward, isn't it? So I was doing marriage counseling in advance. So for now, you do not require a wife. You can still have, by the way, let me tell you something very interesting. Studies have shown the most lonely women are the married ones. Yet many studies have shown that the most lonely women are married women. You know, when she was single, she had her friends, her girlfriends, she could talk to them. She gets married and the husband sees her with another woman and says, what are you discussing? Because she doesn't want to mess up her marriage, she closes all communication with her former girlfriends. But unfortunately, this guy is not available. So the most lonely women are married women. So if you don't learn how to make friends as a single, do not think marriage will sort you out. Are we together? So what I'm trying to get you to see clearly is that you need. By the way, they may not benefit from your relationship. These people may not even be willing to share. But in as long as three things are clear in them. First, they are technically qualified in the area you are sharing on. Because that is important for you to change. Number two, they have confidentiality. They cannot share the information with somebody else. Number three, they love you. They desire your good. Those are three qualifications for that small group that you are going to share with. It's normally assumed that your relatives are likely to be that group. But many of your brothers are competitors. It's called sibling rivalry. So that if you start sharing with your brother, he will destroy you, isn't it? So you need to pick a person, whether it's a brother or a friend, somebody who qualifies on those three counts. Then you have to, because I am suggesting to you that it will help you to develop. If you don't know yourself well enough, you may think you are okay. The more you know yourself, the more you realize you require help. Am I right? And sharing is a very, very important thing. So I hope you can see, I'm not suggesting you have to get married, because I'm already aware many married people don't share anyway. So, but that's a bad marriage. I was talking about a good one. I think it's important for you to know you have to, and they are there everywhere. And I'm saying, even if they don't share themselves, as long as you are benefiting, continue the relationship. Yes? Sorry? The public area. Now, you know, I realize I'm taking too long. I'll still expect you to read the book. But let me tell you, whenever you see a mission statement or a vision statement that is inward looking, it's not a Christian thing. We are all created to benefit mankind to God's glory. So the reason you are alive, your mission statement, is not to be the richest man south of the Sahara, north of Limpopo. That's not a reason. It is to do something with the money God gives you. Are we together? You know, I normally like giving this example. If you are driving towards Nakuru, every November, December, you know around Limuru, what are the fruits you see there? Those of you who got that direction. What are those fruits called?
Plums.
Let me tell you, the Limuru people plant them, although they take 1 year to grow. They plant them. But I want to tell you, not a single plum tree has ever eaten a plum. You know, plums are very good. They are the ones that make jam, isn't it? But not a single tree has ever eaten plums. Plums grow for Nganga and Otieno and Kanyango as they go to buy the fruit. Are we together? In the same way, you are seated here, very fruitful, but you cannot eat your own fruit. Am I communicating? God created you for the benefit of others. So the mission statement must be how God will use me to impact others. Are we together? So that should be your vision. Because I'm alive, this is how the world will change. Not about me. It's about them. So what I'm trying to say then, public area means, what is it I will do in order to fulfill my mission that attaches public? You know, the personal area is still part of public, but the personal area is a forgiving area. Because even if I mess, they can easily forgive me. In the public area, they will sacrifice me. They might hang me, maybe not from my neck, but from my legs. But they will still hang me in the public area. So it's important, that's why we say, have a personal area. It's what we call a pilot study. Whatever God shows you in the private area, before you go announcing it in the public, announce it in the personal area. And depending on the kind of reactions you get, you understand how to place the message. By the time you go to the public area. So your activities in the church, your activities in the community, your activities in employment, those three areas are all public area. So am I clear now? Yes, brother. Yes. First of all, St. Francis of Assisi says that we should seek to understand more than to be understood. So what does that tell you from the beginning? That there will be no more to be misunderstood. Like I told you my example of being misunderstood. In that time in 1975, did I tell you? I was totally, not a little. You know, by that Sunday service, I was going to church and there was a lady who had converted from Catholicism and they were talking loudly. I didn't know, looking at me, people looking at me, and they are not confronting me. They are just talking about me and we are going to church or coming out of church. You feel so ostracized. You feel the enmity in the air hanging because they felt so fed up. How could you get us into something? And they are not giving you a chance to explain. That is misunderstanding. The one thing I have learned is that if you fear to be misunderstood, chances are you will never accomplish anything. Because every time you stand up, chances are you will be misunderstood. And sometimes you are not misunderstood. You actually say something nonsensical. These days I did, because I like to hear what I said. And you need to understand some of the things I hear. I wonder, is that Nanga talking? Somehow as I was talking something, I said something that I thought that meaningless, a gibberish. Chiwere nganga, what are you saying? Now if I can't understand myself, are you not getting to understand? Are you getting the point? Those are normal things. So the first thing I want you to understand is, it will be normal to be
misunderstood.
Let me tell you the second thing. With every misunderstanding is a learning. Like I now learned the lesson from that incident, where I must be clear to the committee until the committee understands how they are making the decision. Don't rush something. If something goes wrong, the committee will find it difficult to take responsibility. Are we together? Don't say, I'm chairman. I said it. You said it, then you'll hang alone when something goes wrong. It's important. So I learned something. So out of his misunderstanding, you learn something. Thirdly, you must seek God's help in order to know what to say and how to say it. Are we together? So it's important that misunderstanding is not something you can do. And the way you know friends is, somebody say love is blind. It's not blind, it's that it's accommodative. Are we together? You know, some people are like a bed sitter. Do you know what a bed sitter is? They were built in when Umoja was built, some of the houses were bed sitters. A bed sitter is a complete house, but where you sit is where you sleep, and the kitchen is next. Or in one room. The only place that is different is the toilet. Because the toilet person would not want to see. Have you seen a bed sitter? Everything happens at the same place. Some people are bed sitters. They cannot accommodate anybody else. Imagine your mother, you're a man, and your mother is visiting Kenyatta Hospital and says, I'll come to stay with you when I'm going for the checkup. And you realize you're a bed sitter. You wonder, what do I do? How do I tell your mom? Although I stay in Nairobi. Are you getting the point? Please, ask the Lord to give you several rooms in your heart. Don't be a bed sitter. In other words, you must be able to accommodate people. They are not like you. They'll mess you up. They'll cry. They'll do whatever. But in as long as you have another bedroom, they can snore in their room. Now, your heart must have another room, so you are able to accommodate people who are not like you. Am I communicating? And it's important. Friendship is not possible without your ability to accommodate others. And it will be important that you learn that idea. Do you know something? When you love someone, they can say something where everybody else is rising up. But you, the first thing you do is to start excusing them. Saying, I can understand why they said that. After all, they were annoyed. I understand the annoyance. And although you still tell them that was a bad thing, you tell them in such a way that they can see you are not condemning. Are we together? That's what friends are for. The way you know your friends is like listening to your stories. The way you know people are not your friends is they get very easily tired of your waste of time. Whatever you say is like waste of. I still remember my grandmother and my grandfather. Whenever I visited their house and sometimes I stayed with them, I was surprised. Because by the time I was 6 years, I already started asking my grandmother. Surely you can't pretend. Because my grandfather started the story. By the time they were hitting 80 and 90. And my grandfather starts telling the story of what happened in the First World War, then what happened in the Second World War. The first time I'm so interested. The next time he repeats the story, I'm bored. But my grandmother says, atea. Now, I say, my grandmother, that story we have been told 5 times. Keep quiet. That's why they were married. Am I communicating? They are able to tolerate one another. So you need friends. You need friends who are able to accommodate you. Am I communicating? And those are the people that will help you to develop. Because once people know you are, and you know they are so free, everybody was telling you, that was a wonderful talk. They tell you, that was a wonderful talk. But do you remember the statement you gave? It was a terrible statement. It can very easily be misunderstood. Nobody else is telling you except your true friends. Like if they have a piece of ugali at the back, most people will not even mention. They say, yeah, Nanga, you are smart. They are not telling you there is a piece of ugali at the back. But your own friends will not only tell you, they also remove the ugali. Am I communicating? So the misunderstandings are real. But friends are the people who will tolerate whatever you have said wrong, and you love them for it, then you become open to be able to share.
You have provoked, and I have to finish since I know my time is already gone. Now, you have provoked a very important thing. I still remember an MP, just about our age, telling me, Nana, since I became an MP, all Christians have ostracized me. I say, let's be frank. Where were you meeting with those Christians in fellowships? Do you attend them? No. So who left the other? Most of the people who claim, most of the leaders who claim to be without fellowship, it is them who left fellowship. You know, when they come to church, they expect the pastor to say, welcome everybody, and honorable so and so. But you know, in church, you are not honorable. You are brother. Am I communicating? So, since we all came to pray, the pastor will not even mention you. We are all beggars in the hands of God, isn't it? Now, and he'll tell you, no wonder they didn't even mention me. These people, you know, I'm one of them. They don't care. Are we supposed to care and make you special? If you are an MP, remember there's also a managing director here, isn't it? So, must I mention all the people in church? So that's the first thing you need to learn as a leader. That a leader is not better than the members. He is one among equals. And you need to understand there are people who never entered this year and they are 10 times better than you. But this year only needed 10 people. So many people who are better than you never be joined this year. If you go with that concept, you are always at peace with people. This week, one of the campuses wrote to me and called me bishop. I wrote back and said, hey, this letter has come to me by error. This address you are using is for Brother John Nganga. And I wrote back, of course, I was provoking the young man. He wrote back and said, no, I meant it for you. But I said, I've never been a bishop, not even been tempted to be one. So how do you call me bishop? So I wrote back and explained to him, in church, all of us are brothers. Brother Nganga, the bishop. Brother Nganga, the reverend. Are we together? Please go through the Bible and see Paul. He is Brother Paul, the apostle. We are not denying the task he does, but his title is not Apostle Paul. His title is Brother Paul, the. And you please don't believe me. Go and check for yourself in the Bible. The first time I studied it, I was in surprise. How the church can be doing the opposite? Now, instead of calling somebody Brother Kamau, the bishop, we call him Bishop. And if you don't call him bishop, he might easily change your dental formula. Because he's so annoying. How did you forget I'm called bishop? All of us are brethren. If you are to use the New Testament lingo, all of us are brethren. So in the same way, once you join DCF, you don't become something special. You remain simply a brother or a sister in the Lord. If you go with that, because you see, as soon as you are there and you are chairman or you are something, they want to see how you are likely to behave. Because other people have behaved wrongly. They assume even you will behave wrongly. So they are giving you a chance. If you start behaving special, they will no longer relate with you. If they realize nothing has changed, your fellowship will continue. So it doesn't depend on them. It depends on you. And if you are not having good fellowship with the people, don't blame them. It's you. Because you are the one who left them. It's only you who can come back. Initially, they wonder to see. But once over time, they realize you are just a sister, you'll be okay. Unfortunately, that's not an easy thing. Because there are certain things you discuss in DCF that must not be repeated to the fellowship. So I'm not suggesting that you becoming friends with them is repeating what they say, because then you'll go to hell. In the sense that you discuss something confidential, the DCF assumes it's confidential. Even if you share it outside, DCF will not know, but the Lord knows. And your new title is a DCF member who is a liar. Are we together? Because as you come back, you are lying. So you must make sure that being friends with them does not mean that you tell them everything. After all, you yourself know there are things you have not told your friends, isn't it? So how come that on the DCF matters you want to share them? So if the reason they are colliding with you is because you are not telling them confidential matters, that's okay. But you must explain to them that in DCF we have agreed that until a matter is ready to be announced, we as a committee have agreed those matters must not be shared. And so, my friends, please understand, I will not necessarily comment on every matter you are criticizing on the DCF. Because being in the committee, I don't do that. But it's not that I don't like you. It's because I don't want to go to hell. And if I start sharing with you, I'll go to hell. Now, if you explain that way, then people will finally understand. And to me, I haven't really had any problem with the people, whether at work, like I'm the one who began the Shell Fellowship in 1985. I was a junior person. By the time I retired, I was in the leadership team. I still attended the lunch hour fellowship. But most people, when they become managers, they can't go to the fellowship. Why? It's Mama Chai who is in the fellowship. But you know, once we are in the fellowship, we are Brother Nganga, Sister Wanjiru. Now, that's how we discuss. Yet, when I go to the boardroom, I'm the boss of the boss of her boss. We may be three or four grades different. But in the fellowship, she is sister and I am brother. That's what I find very interesting, that people don't understand that your title does not change you. You are simply a member of the fellowship. And many, many of our pastors are the ones who have set the bad example. As soon as he becomes pastor, he cannot relate properly with the membership. Because he forgets that you can be a pastor, but you are still Brother Karaoke the pastor. Pastor is a secondary race. It's just like you are Brother Karaoke the pastor, she is Sister Wanjiru, the sweeper of the church. Both of you are brethren, isn't it? One sweeps the church, the other one preaches. Both ministries are important, am I right? So they must be done. That's the way to deal with it. I hope you start understanding that I'm not suggesting it is easy. I'm only saying it is doable. Who wants to be the last to comment? You know, first of all, we know we are not 80% Christian. I've always asked, when somebody refuses to be born again, because most of the Protestant churches preach salvation, am I right? Yet 90% of the people are not born again in many of the churches, am I right? Now, so these ones who have refused to be saved, yet they have had the message, are they not rebels? But they are part of the church. And you can't throw them out, because the Bible says the tares and the wheat must grow together. So no church is allowed to throw away those pretenders. They are welcome. And it's not you welcoming them. The Bible welcomes them. Are we together? Now, with that, so do not get cheated by the 8% rule. But even if you are to go in my estimate of 20%, still the impact is not as much as it should be. So your question still remains. And I want to tell you, our topic today is the determining factor of your question. Many people have public Christianity. They don't have the private Christianity. And because what they are struggling is how to do things in the eyes of others, instead of their personal area with God, they don't have the inner fortitude to say no to the temptations of sin. So once they go to the corporate world, power corrupts. An absolute power corrupts? Absolutely. And as you get senior in your place of work, somebody has said, this statement was supposed to be true in geography, it became true in church. The higher you go, have you done that in geography? The higher you go, it becomes. Is that supposed to be true in geography? But it's happened to be true in the church. That most of the people who are fervent are junior people. As soon as people become managers, MPs, you don't see them a lot. Like we came out of campus in the 70s, really running all over. We were called gorillas, preaching everywhere. By the time we became managers, 5, 6, 10 years later, by the mid-80s, we become fewer and fewer. These days I meet people and say, Nganga, you have never changed. I say, was I supposed to change? Because you see, they think that by the time I am closing towards 60, I should not be running around speaking to young people like that. I'll be sitting back. Where did we agree with the Lord that you give him the physical energy and I'll use it idle, by being idle? Am I communicating? So it is the personal management which has really lacked. Where you do things in groups
And so if the group stops ministering, you also stop. Little knowing, your vision about yourself is personal. And God will hold your account into account personally. To me, that's what keeps me. The other thing, and I finish with this, is the knowledge that the day, and that's not about leadership, the day you become a Christian, the day you become a Christian, I've said this many times, and next time you meet me, I'll still repeat it. Because I think it's a very critical thing. The day you become a Christian, you make a choice of Jesus. Because you are not forced. It's your choice, isn't it? Once you make that choice, that's the last choice you ever make in life. And people hear that and they don't believe it. But there's no Christianity with choices. You can't make another choice. The last choice you made is the choice of Christ. After that, Christ uses for you. For example, if you found a young person and you have him say, me, I can never marry a Maasai. Never, I can never marry a Maasai. Don't ask them whether they are saved. You know they are going to hell. Because you know very well, if they are really born again, they will marry whoever the Lord chooses. And if you choose the Maasai, I'm not communicating. So when you see them so sure they never marry a Maasai, it's because they are in charge of their lives. And people in charge of their lives are called non-Christians and in control of the devil. Am I communicating? The day you become a Christian, you lose all choices. Even the jobs you do. You don't choose. Like somebody says, how do you work for share for so long? Because I don't hear the call of God into another. In every Christian, the company you work for, you must hear God's call. Am I communicating? Share may pay me 10,000. This guy promised me 20,000. But I will not go because of the money. I will ask, what's God's call on my life? And they come, Nana, you are a fool. How can you live friendly? I'm not a fool. I'm a Christian. And once you choose to be a Christian, you choose to be a fool for the Lord. Am I communicating? So the reason, and I'm still answering her question, the reason the devil goes is because as you grow older and you grow senior, you think to think you now can make choices of your own. And soon enough, you're completely away. You have to make a choice very early. Do you want to control your life? Control it. But then don't pretend to be a Christian. Because Christians do not choose. Christians listen to God. You know the key word, and I'm not again dealing with this topic, girl-boyfriend relationship. The key word is, you don't choose a wife. You find a wife. Isaac did not choose Rebecca. He found, because Eliezer, when he sat at the well saying, I don't know who's girl, but I'm sitting here. Let the girl who says, whom I ask for water, and he says, I'll give you a camel to be the one you have chosen for your servant, Isaac. In other words, it's God who chose. All he has wanted is to find. So the jargon of a truly born again person is finding, not choosing. So whether the sister you marry will be a figure eight or a drum, it's irrelevant. It is irrelevant. What you matter is that is God's choice. Am I communicating? Yeah. And whether the boy you marry is Afro hairstyle or an Afro, it will not quite matter. What matters is who has God chosen for you. Many, many people, their marriages are going wayward. Why? They opted not to listen to God. They made their own choice. And they chose the figure eight, but inside was the devil. Am I communicating? And once she was home, the spirit and the devil could not stay together. What matters is you must allow God to choose. Because then, whoever it is he chooses will dovetail into you. That's only one example of choice. But I think the answer to this powerless Christianity in Kenya is that ability to assume you're a Christian, yes, you are choosing your own way. Are we together? So that's sorry, I've taken longer than I should have taken. I'm sure I'll be forgiven. May the Lord bless you.
Let's appreciate our speaker once more.